Hi guys, welcome to Take Three Reactors. Shut the fuck up, Matt!
And I'm a paranoid person when I'm not on drugs.
Stop it.
Oh, we're playing this shit.
Stop. 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 Cold open right in it. Okay. All right, guys. Welcome to the summit. We got a lot to talk about. All the Chicago stuff we're going to be talking about. We got a cool panel to talk about it with. We got Matt Kurds. How's it going, Matt?
I'm dead inside.
All right. Well, that answers that. Abe, how's it going?
Hi. I just want to sell this. I bought it on Amazon. It's a fabric shaver. It's just incredible. I loved it, and I just want to shout out the brand. It's called Butyrol. I bought it with my Amazon Prime membership. This is not a sponsored video. Actually, they charged the membership, and I didn't notice until I opened my account, my bank. You know, from Wells Fargo, I can show you my card. Continue.
Just make sure you show us the back so I get that security code.
Oh, yeah. Where's my wallet?
Great. Well, that was something. All right. So let's start out the episode by talking about the Star Wars 5-Way number one contender match that, you know, people on this panel may or may not have watched. I got to watch it live. That was pretty fun. Yeah, it was unfortunately a very quick match. I mean, it was basically just like, hey, we started the match. We got to get done because we only have 30 minutes to record this motherfucker. Because the panel that was in there before was supposed to let out at 1:45, and it didn't end up letting out until almost 2:15, like 2:10. And the Schmodown panel was supposed to start at 2:15. So they really had like no time to get the other people out of the room, get all the people in the room and set up for everything and get everyone ready to go. So everything was just like, here's this competitor, get on the stage. Here's this competitor, blah, blah, blah. And here's question one and here's question two. And if you applaud between questions, we're going to cut your hands off because there was just no time. So it felt really rushed from what we're used to, but it's not really like they couldn't do anything about that. Like they had to get the whole match done within a very small time frame. But I want to hear, Matt, I know you watched this one. What were your thoughts on the match?
Well, my first thoughts are on this whole being rushed thing. It reminds me of a quote from Star Wars. Sometimes we must do things that are requested of us. And apparently Schmodown was requested to condense a 5-way into like half an hour, which they're usually longer. But no, this it was interesting because this 5-way was like all pretty much all rookies. And so it was interesting to sort of see them play against people like Joseph Scrimshaw, who we know you know, in the Star Wars League. Molly Damon, I'm really happy she finally got to compete. There are a couple of newbies who I'm glad that they look like they can expand the Star Wars division. That way it's not just like three people all holding the belt. It was a fun 5-way. It wasn't my favorite. My favorite is still the one when Whitwer won, but that's, you know, there was a lot of storylines going on, but it was still a really, really fun 5-way. And I love how Ken started off with, he started off with the Rise of Skywalker question. Everyone was like, wait, what? And then it was just who plays Rey. Like I'm like, okay, Ken, good on you, sir. That was funny.
Yeah. I think originally that question was supposed to be just like a Force Awakens or Last Jedi question. And they changed it to freak everyone out. Because if you notice, the questions for the Star Wars match were very hard, like a little harder than normal. Reasoning being, if they're going to go up against Alex Damon, they have to be able to answer those questions.
They can't do softballs. Like they can't, right.
and this is just speaking as a big Star Wars fan myself, and I used to, when I was a Schmodown writer, I used to help with the Star Wars League, of course, because it's me. Sulisky has to go deep now, especially with someone like Damon as champion, and I kind of actually like the fact that with the five ways, it isn't like, who's captain of Millennium Falcon in Empire Strikes Back? Like, it's, no, it's because if you can only answer that stuff, Damon's going to, like, KO you, and I like the fact that that's how the questions are being asked now, even in the, you know, the number one contender match to get to Damon. I think that's a great idea. Instead of just sort of treating it like a normal five-way, it's like, no, you're playing Alex Damon. You need to be prepared.
Yeah, and it also leaves some of those easy softball questions for, like, Inner Geekdom League. Because Inner Geekdom, like, it is a specialized league, but at the same time, like, people aren't going to have that knowledge of, like, who was the second lieutenant during this specific scene on the Death Star. You know, like, they, people aren't going to be able to just be like, oh, that's, you know, Emperor Lozo. Like, they're not going to be able to know that off the top, like, the majority of people. But in Inner Geekdom, the majority of people probably would know, like, who was captaining the Millennium Falcon during Return of the Jedi at this point. They'll be like, oh, yeah, that's Lando. You know, like, they'll know that stuff. Like, a little bit off of surface level.
Han Solo was still captain of Millennium Falcon. Lando was just
captain
for the assault.
I said captaining. There is a difference between captain and captaining.
Yeah. Are they? I don't know. I never paid attention in history class. For that.
The person in the process of being the captain of the ship, not the person who was still the owner of the ship,
isn't
right?
Isn't it Kristen a history major?
I am.
Okay. No, I'm a media communications major because I kind of failed at life. But
I can explain you photosynthesis.
Really?
Yeah, I'm a biologist.
That's the way in which plants...
Photosynthesis. Anyway,
what did Master Kara think of this match?
You know, she had a lot of fun during this match. She pooped, and we had to go change her diaper, and then she sat on my lap and watched, and she was very quiet. It was great.
Interesting. She sat quietly, quite like an emperor in Return of the Jedi.
Yeah.
Coincidence?
She
I think
is
not.
The emperor. Look at her.
Plotting there. She's just like, have you ever heard the tragedy of Darth Wing is the wise?
Good. She's like, please don't do that to me. But
again, dark side.
It was the question level definitely went up, and one of the reasons, I don't know if this is super common knowledge, but I definitely know about it, is that Ken actually helped write the questions this time around. Mm-hmm. Because he's, as far as I know, not going to be going back in the ring in the near future. I think he wants to focus on, you know, managing. He wants to focus on getting the Star Wars League to be at a point where it can be competitive again, since really it was just him and Alex, because Sam, unfortunately, is very busy. If you saw kind of the slate of what he's going to be working on, he's been working on Clone Wars. He was on Supergirl. He has the new video game coming out, which he did all the voice work for.
He's
gone. Yeah. He's going to be very busy, and I haven't ruled out the possibility that he's got, you know, some part to play in some of these upcoming TV shows for Disney Plus, or maybe a movie or two. You never know. I think they'd be wise to put him in a live action.
Because even if you're someone like me, I follow Sam on Twitch, and he talks about sometimes a lot. Like, he works with Matthew Wood. He even does, like, small, like, background voices in, like, Force Awakens, The Last Jedi, like, stuff you wouldn't even know, like, just, like, you know, so he does stuff like that, too, and that takes time to play, like, 100, like, background characters just, like, whispering.
Stormtrooper like, number one.
Yeah.
Stormtrooper with a stick, you know, like, yeah. That weird credits, but, yeah, so, you know, after it was Alex and Ken, basically, for two times in a row, I think he, you know, wants to make sure that the Star Wars League can be competitive again before he decides to get back into it. At least that's my thinking on it. And one of the ways to make sure it stays competitive is to have a question set that really makes sure that you have the top level players in this league, because you have to. When every competitor is basically studying using Alex Damon's videos, which they all are, mm-hmm. you know, you have to be able to have competitors that can play to his level.
Because I kind of like that as a Star Wars fan myself. I like, you know, being able, like, I answered quite a few questions in this match. Just saying, Harloff, call me in, coach. I like the fact that because Star Wars is a smaller, specialized league, instead of, like, inner geekdom bar title matches, has a couple of softballs in there, you know, for people who study, like, really crazy, like a Kalinowski and a you know, Smasher and, you know, those people. But, you know, they have, like, a, you know, when was the first Avengers movie released? But that's a bigger league, and that's what I like, is Star Wars is smaller, but it can still be super competitive on, like, a completely different level than all the other Schmodown leagues, because you only have a select number of, you know, movies to choose from, and if they wanted to go even crazier, they could expand Star Wars to including, which I don't think they would, but, like, including, like, the TV shows and stuff like that, bring Rebels and Clone Wars the show in, and I like that. It makes it more interesting, because you know whoever faces Alex, whether it be Scrimshaw at Chicago or whoever he faces at, you know, the next event or whatever, they're gonna be the best of the best. It's not gonna be someone who, you know, somehow slipped through the cracks and just got a lot of lucky goes in, you know, five ways. Like, it's someone who's gonna present a challenge to him, which is, you know, awesome.
Yeah, definitely. So, and yeah, Matt knows things, I guess. Does he? I don't know.
Let's just say this. This is just a little pre-promo. I'm going to be the guy who explains Star Wars to Star Wars Explained. How about that for you?
That's not true. Like I said, everyone in the league studies using Alex's videos. So
true. I watch Alex's videos too.
Well, it's funny too, because you mentioned that they're going to have to expand to, you know, TV shows, which I kind of like the idea of it, but I was talking to Andrew about that, and he said something I found pretty interesting. And he's like, if you do that, if you include books or comics or the TV shows, then Alex wins hands down, because he does all of, like, he does video content on all of that. He studies all
I follow Alex, and he literally, what he does is, like, he reads a book, and then you get, like, a 15-minute breakdown of, like, every little, like, connection to the entire guy. I mean, to me, as a Star Wars fan, let me just pause here and, like, Abe, do an ad. If you are somehow watching our content or the Schmodown and you're not watching Star Wars Explained, what are you doing? It's amazing.
It's amazing.
Him and Molly, their Q&As are so funny sometimes, the questions they get asked. And you gotta respect Alex for his favorite character being someone who's, like, in barely 20 minutes of the original movie. You gotta respect that.
It is. I mean, that is true. The other thing is, I know you touched on some of the rookies in this match, and we'll move on to the actual Star Wars match in just a second. But the rookies in this match, I thought, were really impressive. I kind of thought Andrew was going to do well. I did think Molly was going to win, just because I liked the idea of it being a
husband wife and
husband final.
Just be funny.
Exactly. I thought that was going to be a lot of fun. But I was really surprised by Andrew and also by Laura, just because, like, I mean, I didn't really know anything about if they were going to be good or bad. I figured Andrew would be good because, as a fan, like, you have to prove yourself to Harloff before he'll let you in. Yeah. Laura's more in the business at, you know, as a vlogger. I think she's from Chicago as well. So that was kind of cool.
But she
was so good.
Like, how Schmodown, you know, it's kind of like Peak Girl Diva got into the five-way with Whitwer and Damon and all of them, because
she
writes for Starbucks.com. So with that, it's like, not that they wouldn't know stuff, but, like, you're like, oh, well, they're in the business where it's like someone like a fan, like, you know, they had, like, this Skype audition with Harloff.
Right.
And he put them through the ringer. So you're like,
oh, this is someone who's going to come out. And I have to say, as a fellow Best Man Fatigues fan myself, that was a good jacket choice there. I have one of those hanging in my closet, too.
yeah, but I was very impressed by Laura. I figured that she was going to be okay, but she ended up being, you know, better than... She could have won the whole thing.
I'm sorry, Harloff, can we get a singles match between them in Star Wars? I don't care if it's for a number one contender. Can we just get that?
I definitely think that everyone who played in that, except maybe the Rooster Teeth guy, will be back for another Star Wars match before the end of the year. Who knows when? I feel like there's going to be another championship match this year, so there's got to be another contender match, obviously. But I, you know, we have a lot of competitors now. It might be nice to have like a little mini tournament, just like three matches. Honestly, do like two singles matches and then do, you know, a competitor match or a contender match and then do the finals. I would love that. I think that would be a great way to get these rookies to have an actual chance to play a little bit more.
And it's also just a way to build the league. It's just like, because five wins are great, but I think what was starting Aaron Geek last year was like the five wins were fine, but what really got interesting in Aaron Geek was that mini tournament.
Yeah.
Got interesting was that mini tournament. The five ways were fine, but it was the mini tournament that we all loved. Do that for Star Wars this year. And I know scheduling is crazy with Schmodown. They're doing so much.
The Star Wars competitors are not like the other competitors that all live in California. Like Andrew's in Florida. Molly and Alex are in Georgia. I'm pretty sure Laura's Illinois or in the Midwest area.
A lot of them don't live.
Yeah, like, they're all over.
Ken and Joseph and Sam, they all live in LA.
Right. So it's a little bit harder, but at the same time, I know that all of them, as far as I know, are willing to travel out there if they're given the chance to compete again. So I'm excited to see all of them. I got to hang out with Andrew and his wife, Nikki, a lot, and they're very nice people. So I ended up not wanting to root for them before I met them. And as soon as we met them and talked to them, I'm like, darn, I have to change who I'm rooting for in this match. So I wanted Andrew to win. He was really close. He was so now close.
But Kristen, now the real question comes down. If it comes to me and Andrew...
You're my son, but.
Wow! You heard it here first, folks! Fredo! Win against the family!
I'm sorry, Matt. I'm sorry. I just think he'll win. I know how well he did during the final, and he could have won that final match. He was real close. I think he only got three or four wrong that entire finals match, so that's pretty decent.
Didn't hear what you said. Don't care to hear it.
All right. Anyway, we can talk about the final match now, which was between Jessel Crenshaw and Alex Damon. And honestly, I don't know if having to play at that level 2 days in a row maybe hurt Jessel Crenshaw's chances. Like, he had to go from... playing against five people in a really hard match and then playing Alex Damon in a really hard match. I don't know, maybe if he had a couple days in between to prepare mentally, if he would have been able to win, because there were a couple things where I just don't think he understood the question fully. There was definitely one that as soon as he answered, I'm like, no, that's very wrong. That's not what they're asking for. It was the catalyst for Finn and Rey meeting, right?
Oh, yeah.
And he never actually intervened in her fight. So I just think if he had maybe a little bit more mental capacity, you know, to think that question through, he might have been able to get it and the match could have gone a very different way. But that, you know, who knows? Maybe it would have made him worse if he had a couple days to think things through. Let's get Abe's thoughts on the Star Wars match since he didn't get to talk about the five-way. What did you think of this Star Wars title match?
Honestly, this is probably one of the best title matches ever, just because of the accuracy rate. I think people underestimate it because we don't have like as much connection with Alex or Scrimshaw like we did with Kalinowski of Cushing, if we have a comparison of that level. What was the final score, Larry? Like 20?
I'll look it up right now. I'm not entirely sure, but Alex only missed one question, I think, and it was a hard question.
Yeah, they missed. What was Scrimshaw only missed one, two?
He missed a couple.
He missed one in round two, and
then his round three.
The betting row. And they and both then his, made those.
They, he missed something in his round three because he lost, right?
No, wait. I don't remember. But
or did it come down to he got all of his round threes and Alex had to answer?
Yeah,
it.
He had.
I didn't rewatch this one, which I probably should have. And when you're in the live setting, it's very easy to just forget details.
The final score was Damon 33, Scrimshaw 29.
Yeah, which is ridiculous.
It's just an just think about it. Like
11 now, I need to look up what Cushing. I need to look up what the Cushing count is.
I think it was 31-30. I think it was 31-30, if I'm not mistaken, or something.
Yeah,
like that.
I mean, and you have to think too. The level of difficulty in these Star Wars questions is way harder than the Intergeekdom questions. Like, I can hold my own in the Intergeekdom league. I cannot hold my own at all in the Star Wars league. And I'm a fan of Star Wars, but I can't do what these guys are doing. Like, I wouldn't win.
Ever. That's just a bit like, I might or I might not have answered more questions than Alex Damon. I didn't, but...
You didn't. No one... And my hot take at this point is I know everyone wants to see a Whitwer-Damon match. I think Damon wins easily if they have a rematch because Damon has been studying. Like, he has been studying the matches. He wants to face Whitwer because he wants to beat him. And he's been studying everything that's Whitwer's strengths. He's been studying everything that's his weakness. And he's literally, he's almost perfect in terms of what he knows at this point. And it's really scary.
This is the thing is if we're going based on just pure like raw knowledge, it's like we'll say they're both very even. But if it's going based on like, it's hard to say because if Sam had time to prepare and to be able to do, there's a lot, cause they're both super knowledgeable. They're the two best we've seen. I think Alex wants to play Sam because the way he won the belt was not the way he wanted to. He won the belt in the same way that Tommy Gunn won the belt in Rocky V, where Rocky retired with the belt and they got a new champ who wasn't Rocky. And so it was like this weird thing where it's like, you are the champ. You did beat the champ, but the champ didn't beat the champ. So it's that weird sort of thing that you get sometimes. That's, I think, why he wants to play it. I want to see that match just because I love Whitmer and Damon so much to just see. Based on right now, I probably get the edge to Damon because of what you've said. He's been studying the matches. He's been, Star Wars Explained, they've been doing a ton of stuff. So, and Sam has not had any time to study, let alone, I think, watch a Star Wars movie, more or less, like, really sit down and, like, examine every little piece of it.
Yeah.
But yeah, to now get back on track and get my thought, I thought the Scrimshaw Damon match was fantastic. I feel so bad for a new member of the Bridesmaid Club, along with Mark and Draco and Ben Bateman, Joseph Scrimshaw, who just is never able to get that belt. It's okay. We all still love you. As a bridesmaid on a late night debates, I know what it's like, Joseph. Force Center is great. Just on the off chance you watch that. It's not a term, it's a term of endearment as a bridesmaid myself. That was upsetting, but Damon was so dominant. Like, it was insane. I'm trying to remember what question he lost on.
In round three, it was one of about a commander in the Empire Strikes Back, which I did not know. But
now I'm just going to go crazy looking for that. But regardless, like, it's probably like, who was this background character who had like a fraction of a line? But yeah, still, Damon was amazing. It was a great match, and yeah, I loved it. It was. I'm not sure. The Ken Sam Iron Man match is still my favorite, but this might be the best played Star Wars match we've seen. I don't know. It's hard to compare an Iron Man match to a regular match, but regardless, I'm just rambling on here now because I don't know where to go.
Well, I can take it over. This was a great match. And I mean, it was weird because this was the first, we're talking about it first because this is the match that they recorded first. So they aired them out of order, but the Star Wars match was played first and then the team's match was played. So in my brain, it only makes sense to talk about it first. But this to
also
me,
it doesn't have as much behind after stuff to talk about.
I mean, yeah, there's really nothing afterwards to talk about here, other than who we think Alex should play next, which I think we all want Whitwer. And you know, if I'm Alex and I want to say that I'm the best player, you have to play the best player. And at this point, the only other person that he has not beaten yet, who everyone pretty much considers to be the best player, is Whitwer. So I think he's going to get eventually to play Whitwer. In my mind, I want that to happen. I know he wants that to happen. So we'll see. But let's move on to the team's match. This was also a really good match. It ended. It was an unsatisfying end. We'll just put it there. I was very unsatisfied with the end of this match. And the everything before it, I thought was great. But then the ending, I was just like, dang. Because there was no suspense. It was just, oh, yeah, they lost. Before the question was even answered. Yep, they lost. Which sucks. I hate when matches kind of end like that. Where it's just like there's no suspense. It's just he messed up and you can't do anything about it. But let's hear, Abe, do you want to talk about this team's match?
Do you want to talk about the match? Do you want to talk about the slap? Do you want to talk about the interviews? What do you want to talk? Because I could talk about the match. I thought, I was thinking the Odd Couple was going to win. I didn't see. I was thinking who's the boss at the beginning, but then I said the Odd Couple. I think they're on fire. And I talk about with Matt about this, what's coming up with the Odd Couple. I think the season playing of just Jeff Snyder and team is what makes a difference in those. He's able to rattle his opponents, whatever you want to say or not. Like he does little things that can take you out of the game. Maybe a couple of seconds, and those couple of seconds are important. Like it was seen in the last question when they asked for a JT rule and they did not have it. So there are little distractions that he's able to do that take the competitors away, which can mean a right answer, a point, 2 points, whatever it was. But honestly, like I think Mark and Drake was the MVP of the match. He had a perfect round one. They did not miss one in the second match. He answered his round three question. Oh, so he made the difference. Also, Jeff played really well. So also, two of the boss also played an incredible game. Like round one was not as amazing, but they did not miss a single question in round two. I think they went 12 for 12, and it's like the third time they do this. So
yeah, it was.
They're no slouch. Like it's been proven. So
yeah, your point. Both teams played really, really well. For me, the first three rounds, it was pretty much Mark Andrako's game. It was both Mark's game because Mark Riley also played just ridiculously well in this match, and I feel like. You know, Jeff Snyder was playing really well, but Mark held their team up. And then, if Mark Andrako hadn't been on his game, I mean, he was just perfect in this match. And if he had been off his game, even a percentage, this would have gone a very different way. I was very impressed with Mark Andrako in this match. Matt, I know that you're feeling a little unfortunate about this and, you know, I'm sorry. I can feel your pain from here, but why don't you talk about the match and we'll watch you cry on screen, which is our favorite thing to do.
If you don't talk, the camera doesn't change.
Matt's ugly crying off camera, so we'll join him once he
in that one record
stops ugly crying. You okay, Matt? Nope.
I'm trying to set up a joke, so just give me a second here.
Oh, okay. Well, Matt's trying to set up a joke, so and this is definitely not going to be cut from the final recording. So this joke better be real good. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah.
I actually, after the match, was talking to Riley, and I was just, because Matt had put in the chat how upset he was in one of our chats, and I was talking to Riley about it, and I'm just like, Matt is really sad, and he's just like, oh, poor Kearns. it was so funny. He was just like, he's a good kid.
I just want to say, I'm Kearns. Not that in that chat, so I guess I'm not part of the, what's the name? Well, give me a sec.
You, not everyone is a part of every chat, you know.
You know what? Like,
sorry. Sorry, Abe. Maybe if you like showed up at events and we could talk to you in real life, you'd be part of more chats.
Oh yeah, but like this fucking joke, it better be the funniest thing ever.
Better, you know. Yeah. I mean, the build up to this joke is pretty impressive. I'll talk about the match real quick. I really enjoyed this match. I thought, like I said, Mark Andrenko was definitely MVP of the whole thing. Snyder, he's such a loose cannon in general with his personality for the matches. Not his personality in real life. I think he's less of a loose cannon in real life, but definitely in the matches, his match character is so like crazy and disruptive, which is fine. That's his character. But in a live setting, he amps it up so much and it's almost too much for me, which is fine. You know, it is what it is, but he was maybe a little too distracting while they were reading questions and things, which they need to watch that because they do have only a set number of repeats. And especially in the live setting where it's hard enough to hear the questions being read anyway, right? Like they just need to tell people to tone it down. If they're going to do all that stuff, it has to be in between questions being read or whatever, you know? So that's just what I thought about that.
I just want to say, I think that's who's the boss fault, because they push the questions. They like to wait and you don't like, it's going to bite you in the ass. One's going to bite you in the ass. And it happened this match. They were thinking, I think at the end they gave the wrong answer anyways. But like, yeah, they could have like a couple, I guess, 15 seconds more, right? 15 seconds more to think about it. Maybe correctly, you know, sometimes the answer comes at the last second. But I mean, it's part of the strategy. Many, like what happened with Jane Fonda? We go back like a year ago. Rocket did not want to repeat the question in round 3 because they thought they were going to they bite on us. Like, just those couple of seconds could change that match completely. So that's just part of the strategy the players decide. I think it was that. So please give me the best fucking joke of my life, Matt.
Yeah, Matt. If we don't die laughing, then Matt?
Listen, what do you want me to say? They lost. They lost to a bunch of assholes being managed by a witch. Okay? Mark Andrenko is the biggest heel in the Schmodown. And if Brooklyn or any of you other Andrenko people are like, nah, he's not a heel. Snyder is a shirt. He's a villain. He's a villain. And he's just a dick. And Frank Janusz stole Kristen's sweatshirt. What do you want me to say? They lost. Is this funny? Is it funny for me to be your monkey on the organ grinder? Ooh, watch Matt cry. And then the people in the comments and on Facebook and my mom will be like, it's just a movie trivia show. I'll be like, no, it's more than that. It's a movie trivia show plus wrestling, which airs every Thursday and Friday on the Movie Trivia Showdown YouTube channel, but it's more than that.
Was there a joke in there? Or
I did not laugh once. I you know what the thing? I think it's because you get it, and there are a lot of people that don't get it. Cause you may be a big WWE fan, and you get what happens. You probably your mom does not get it at all. I think that is what's happening.
If I can break it for a second, what I was
because trying, you're a big fan. That's the thing.
No, because my phone wasn't working. I originally had Google Translate. That way, a robotic voice could have done my whole speech, but then my phone decided to not work. So that's the problem I ran into.
I'm sorry, Matt. In any case, yeah, Matt.
First, you have a Mark. Called Matt. Me a good kid. I mean, I'm 20, but I know I have fat, childish-looking features, but it's okay, Mark.
In any case, Matt mentioned the sweatshirt, which, let me talk about the sweatshirt, because I don't know if Frank is going to mention this or not.
Talk about it!
So before the match, Frank and Tom. So
I thought we were gonna be showed out every single week in the roundup, but we have never been on since he joined a year ago.
Frank and Tom had a bet going on before the match, basically, which was if the Odd Couple won, then Tom's Bobby and the Juice sweatshirt would go to Frank, and if you know his team won, then he would get to keep the sweatshirt. And before the match started, Frank was like, is the bet still on? And he's like, I'm gonna change it. If I win, she gets the shirt, and just pointed at me, and I was like, what? He was like, I want her to have the shirt, and there's no way we're losing, so she's gonna get the sweatshirt. And I was like, okay.
Wait, cool. It was your fault? It was
not my fault. I didn't even know what was going on. So then after the match, I didn't even remember about the bet because I was barely even a part of it, right? Like, I had no idea what was going on. So then he hands Frank the shirt, and he's like, I'm really sorry that you didn't get the shirt. And I was like, God damn it, I forgot about the stupid sweatshirt.
Kristen told me all this in the same message where I told her, BT Dubs, by the way, it wasn't in a group chat. Those were private messages that were sent to Kristen.
You're right. I'm sorry.
That's good to know.
I have a question.
My bad.
What's the difference between a sweatshirt and a hoodie?
It's the same.
It's just name. It's the same thing. It's just the name.
Okay. Yeah. I called it a sweater with a cap.
By
the way, speaking of Little Bobby and the Juice, you can go to their Indiegogo page and support the show. They have a lot of great perks on there. I haven't backed it yet because I don't know how much money in my bank account I can sell.
I think John will dump some money in there for his BFF Tom.
He'll do the $50 one so he can talk to Tom for half an hour on Skype.
Yeah.
Right.
Dad, nice to see you didn't abandon this child on a trip. That's good to see you're learning.
Well, this wasn't really a trip. We live here, so it's I mean, it's hard to abandon someone where you live. In any case, this was a great match. It just ended very unsatisfying, in my opinion. I know everyone only wants to hear us talk about one thing, and that's the slap.
It's the scarf.
You're right.
It's the scarf. It's a beautiful scarf. I like the ensemble he was going for.
No, it's definitely the other S word, the slap. The slap. The TV show, The Slap.
Right. If you're a fan of Actuary Anatomy, that show, they used to reference it early on, like, all the time. They would be like, whenever they would talk about, like, Star Trek 09, it would be like, Zachary Quinto from The Slap. So that just is funny in this. Yeah, what the fuck was that? I have many thoughts on that. What was that?
Yeah, so anyway, obviously, you hopefully would have watched the Schmodown match, if you're watching this. Roxy, so Jeff and both Mark and Draco, which was a bit of a shock, refused to shake the hands of Ben and...
No. I have to correct you right
now. No.
They refused to shake Ben's hand. They said it. Riley never offered his hand.
They never offered their hands. They refused to shake Ben's hand, and I at that point I don't think Mark needs to offer his hand. He's offended for his teammate, right?
Yes.
He's gonna stand by his man after all. You know, he's a big fan of that song.
Just like Minnie Driver sang in GoldenEye.
Right. Stand by your man. He was standing by his man. But then Roxy comes up and she's like, I don't know, you know, what's going on with these guys. That was just wrong. And then she slaps Ben in the face. It was a weird turn of events. And it definitely was a big shock to everyone live, and I'm sure it was a big shock going by the comments on every single page ever. A big shock to everyone. So let's talk about it, and we'll start with Matt. Matt, how do you feel for your boy Ben?
How do I feel for my boy Ben? I feel like that was just an insulting thing to do. You know, talk about just rubbing a win in to just physically assault him. But the real thing here is, I like that the Odd Couple will be going into this title match with no manager. Because if Andrew Guy gets banned for tackling Ben Bateman, which is a physical assault, Roxy Stryer should get none but less. And if you try and pull this relationship stuff, you could say that Guy was tackling Ben for the same kind of relationship stuff too, because in Guy's eyes, Ben cheated on him with another guy. Okay? So don't come at me with that stuff. Now listen, Roxy, I listened to the one-on-one. I feel bad that Ben spent so much time studying and that affected stuff. But listen, that doesn't mean you can slap people. John Smith abandoned me in California. If I saw John Smith in New York, did I slap him? No. I gave him many angry glares, but I did not slap that man. And that was my father abandoning me. That's okay. What I have to say about that. You are going to be banned, oh, and you are not. I will write a very angry email to Christian Harloff and Emma Fife. I probably won't. Like, I'll write it, but then I won't send it. I will tweet a very angry tweet is what I will do.
Sure. Okay. Well, Matt, you're a grown man, so you're going to have to figure out how to live your life without John in it eventually anyway. We were mama birding you, not in the terms of feeding, in the terms of mama birds will push their young out of the nest when it's time for them to grow the heck up.
But so could you at least let me with a plane ticket or something?
No, I'm sorry, Matt. Birds, literally, when they're like, all right, kids, you got to grow up, the nests in the tops of trees.
Yeah, but at least the birds have wings at that point.
If you're an eagle, they put you in a mountain, dude. That's tough.
If
there was a
this video. But we're not birds. Why you died?
Oh, look at you.
Don't be a bitch.
I learned only from the best, Dad.
That's the best advice I'll ever receive.
Well, I mean, yeah, the slap. Okay, I'm not. What I'm, did you say? I don't want to break kayfabe, but at the same time,
like you've been on the MTS page.
You cannot break kayfabe.
Very seriously. If you have not figured out yet that the storylines in the Schmodown are scripted, there is something wrong with you. Do you think that people are actually tackling each other and they're just getting it on camera? Like, oh, assault is hilarious. Let's just put this on camera. No, it's like, scripted.
Yeah. Do you think that they literally let Andrew Guy tackle two people and at no point they're like, Andrew, we're going to send you in for anger management.
I mean, like, have you watched Wedding Crashers? I saw this hilarious in that movie.
Hey, that punch at the end of that movie is amazing. When Vince Vaughn just knocks out Bradley Cooper, it's a...
Like, I mean, if you know any of these people and you know that the majority of them are all friends outside of the Schmodown, even the ones who treat each other really badly in the ring because they're playing heels, they are playing heels. Come on, people. It's like WWE. If you think that's real and you think people are really like slamming each other through tables and that, then there's something wrong with you mentally.
They are actually doing it. I was going to say, they are actually.
It's not like they're doing it because, like, I just really.
It's not malicious. It's not like
it's part. There.
It's not like Hulk Hogan was like. I actually like Hulk Hogan. Andre the Giant had one of the greatest rivalries in wrestling. Hulk Hogan talks about all the times when they were on tour, how Andre the Giant and him would hang out, and how Andre would like fuck with him, like. In like a funny, friendly way. They didn't hate each other, and they had one of the greatest on-screen rivalries in the whole of WWE.
Yeah, I mean,
and then Hulk body slam.
The WWE, all the people who are in there are great athletes, but they're also great actors. Maybe not translated well to TVs or movies, not all of them. But in the WWE,
soap opera actors.
They are all great actors. You know, because they learn how to take all these hits and make them look really, really convincing when some of them aren't actually real. Some of them are, unfortunately, for them. But like they do all this stuff, and it's the same with the Schmodown. The trivia is real. The storylines are stories. They're made to give the trivia matches more oomph, you know?
And they could be based in, like, reality. Like, they could be based in, like, oh, Snyder and Bateman don't, you know, like, they kind of go at it in a friendly way off camera. Let's turn this into a storyline and make them really hate each other.
Mons and Rock at the beginning. I mean, they actually scream at each other every single time they look at the discussing camera.
Where are you going, Sasha?
Well, like I think it's kind of like up for this more like at the beginning. And
but 2016, the storylines of 2016 are completely different to what's going on.
Can I give my thoughts on the slap?
Yes. Tell us.
Okay. So, I just think that this from the beginning because did not play how I thought. But I will punch anybody in the face if they try to punch me.
Stop it!
I just think. Okay, this situation just shows that Thad Williams was the greatest commissioner of all time, because when the guy thing happened, there were actions taken at the moment. What happened when Bateman was tackled? Who was commissioner at the time? Christian Harloff had the power again, right? What happened? Nothing happened for a month. Nobody saw anything. No actions were taken. What happened right now? A decision is going to be taken on Monday. No, these people are not Thad Williams. Thad Williams... It's just, he knows what to do at the moment. He takes right actions, and I just want...
No, I'm sorry, Kristen. He's got a point. When Guy tackled Rocha, he was immediately taken out of the building. He wasn't able to do a post-match interview. Wow, you got a point.
Guy wasn't even playing when he tackled Bateman. That's the thing. He was not even there to be like... Like, he wasn't playing a match.
It took a month for actions to be taken and everybody knew. A month.
Sure. But it was the end of the season. That's why That's why it took a month. It was the end of the season.
A month. Doesn't matter.
You're being a little...
That wouldn't happen under Thad Williams. You're part of the Thad Club, Kristen. Look at me in the eyes and tell me you're not part of the Thad Club.
I like that. But I think
that's why we need Thad back. It's just my thoughts.
No.
Yeah, we do.
Well, we don't need Thad back, but we could have leadership.
He's a better man. He's a better commissioner than or chairman or whatever you want.
I kind of disagree with you a little bit on this.
That wouldn't happen under Thad administration.
It would have happened.
It wouldn't.
Because Christian was pulling all of the strings at that point anyway. It would have still happened.
No. But he'd take action when it was needed. He had all the power in the world.
He had no power.
He had all the power in the world.
Halfway through last season, he had no power.
He was given, by the time when Andrew tackled Rocha, he had all the power.
Right.
Corruption wasn't taken over. Just look at it. That contract hadn't ended with Harloff. It was a match before the main event. You don't know your Shimano history as I do. I will burst. And I just want to say, this wouldn't happen in that administration. And I think Roxy should get banned for 3 months.
Halfway through the season, Thad had no power.
I just want to say, through the season where Thad was in, no physical assault happened through the entire year.
Excuse me, the double toasted match. I'm not over this. They physically assaulted
Christian was commissioner there.
Oh, really?
Yeah, that was May 2017.
Christian, what are you doing? Why are you letting people physically assault
Christian Harloff is the problem. He lets people assault other people. Let's just say it like that.
But we like that. It's fine.
No, I like Christian. He's a great. He's my favorite. I think he's amazing.
I
just want to say he's not a competent commissioner. Because his players attack other players. It's
maybe
not fine.
Never go to Collider. You might be put through a table.
Abe's gonna go through a table. I'm looking forward. I'm really looking forward to this. This has been.
I'm just saying, actions need to be taken.
I agree with Matt.
Does not end with Roxy being banned. Then there is
for 3 months at least.
Yes, three months.
There are going to be actions taken. And Christian was going to completely ban Andrew Guy, and the only reason he did it was because Ben wanted to face him.
Look, that's a problem. That's a problem. That wouldn't let that happen. That wouldn't let that happen. Andrew, he would have taken his decision and put it on. He would have listened to the other player.
For the rest of a season under that. Christian was going to ban him forever.
Okay. Just tell me. How much are you getting paid?
How much am I getting paid?
Yeah, no.
I'm getting new.
Well, Abe, time out. Do we want to look over here? Who was hanging out with Odd Couple after the match, and who's hanging out with Who's the Boss? Because I happen to remember Kristen Smith and John Smith were in the hallway with the Odd Couple at the end of this match, so maybe
I wasn't hanging out with them. I was hanging out with Ryan Snelling. We were just trying to get out of the way. Okay, so to be fair, the Odd Couple was upstairs taking pictures with the VIP people at the time of that post-match interview happening. And so the only people downstairs were the people who weren't in that VIP picture. And those were all the people who did not win in their matches.
Look at how she's not, she looked away at us. She wasn't looking us directly in the eye while she told this story.
I can't look you directly in the eye. My camera's up here and your face is down.
You said it, Kristen. You said it. That is the solution.
I'm just saying, I don't care who's commissioner, actions need to be taken.
Hey,
and if it does not end in a ban hammer, then there is something wrong here. And I will write a strongly worded WordPress article about it. You guys can find me. I'm at MattMovie611 on WordPress. You know all my great articles I posted recently.
All I'm saying is that Thad Williams allowed himself to be controlled and made very bad decisions based on him being too scared to stand up to the people who were controlling him. If you want to say that he ran the league better than everyone else, then you also have to admit that he bitched out. He said, I don't want to have to deal with this person and all their blackmail, and I'm just going to do whatever the heck they tell me to do.
Look, Kristen Smith, I agree with them. However, I think everybody has bad and good things. And that good thing was he always took action when it was needed, when assault happened.
And Christian is doing the same thing.
No, he's taking 3 days.
Yeah, but he wants to wait to do it when everyone can be there.
Oh,
what?
And Roxy can all sit down.
Look, I'm just going to ask you for something. Just to end this. Can you send me the email for Christian Hardlove? Because I need some money right now.
No, all I'm saying is I'm a shill for days. However, I think that you're being a little too crazy. And I understand.
It's because I understand the schmonown.
I understand the schmonown.
You don't really understand the show now, Tom Dagnino. Understands the show now, Tom for commissioner.
We do love Tom. Tom for commissioner in 2020.
And can we just say, what did Ben Bateman ever do? He tried to just shake the hands of these competitors. He gave them the best game he possibly could in Chicago. And what does he get? He gets a refusal from handshakes from his competitors. He gets slapped in the face, and then he gets that video message sent to him from his former comrade.
And a dog.
Poor Ben Bateman. Why are we not talking about
this, man?
This is just upsetting right here. As a Bateman person now, this is just sad.
I think we can debate Thad Williams versus Christian Hargloff all we want.
What we can't debate is Ben Bateman got the short end of the stick.
He got the short end of the stick. I do want to say that I think at this point, there's no reason why he shouldn't be in the Horsemen. I think that they made a very clear choice to have him be slapped, and that he, like, at this point is like full face turn. So
what if, okay, now I'm going to put on my tinfoil hat. What if we get some cutscenes, we get something with Clyde or Live when the decision about the slap comes out? What if it's Rocha who comes to Bateman's defense because he was physically assaulting the Shimano more? And what if that leads to Bateman deciding to join with Four Horsemen because Rocha comes to his defense?
Rocha did come to Ben's defense after Ben was tackled by Andrew Guy.
I know, but at that time he wasn't deciding to let Ben in his faction. Now he's starting to look at him as a possible faction member. And what if this is the thing to where he's like, you know what? you're in the Four Horsemen. I'm going to look after you like I should. So for that, or they could go to people who have been tackled by Andrew Guy therapy. Just saying, I think that cutscene could be really, really funny. There are a lot of great comedic possibilities.
I have a question for Kristen.
Okay, sure.
Kristen, what action do you think need to be taken?
That's true.
I think that Roxy just needs to be banned. I think that they she needs to be banned for at least their shot at the title.
She needs to miss that title shot.
Yeah, she's not allowed to be at the title shot at all. She's not allowed to be at the title shot at all. And if they win the title, I think that she needs to be banned from the next match they have. And if they don't win the title, then who knows when the next time they play is anyway. I just feel like it should be a match limit and not a time limit. Because if they don't win the title, then I don't think they'll play again for like 3 months, right? Like the next time they play could be 5 months, and then she'll only have missed one match. I think it needs to be like
it needs to be like, match, not mom. You know what, Kristen?
You need to have like a 3 match limit or a 2 match limit or something. Especially if they win the title. If they win the title, she's not allowed to be in for like the title defense. And if they don't win the title, then she can't go back. Like they lose their, they can't be in a number one contender match or something. Like I feel like it's not just her that needs to be, slapped on the wrist. I feel like it's the whole team because she's their manager. Yeah. She represents that team, and because what she did. The other managers need to learn what they do is going to impact.
Look at what happened with Fandrico and all that stuff. Tom wasn't able to be there for any of the Patriots stuff when the stuff with, and then the stuff with Emma Fife happened. None of the Lions then was able to be there with Tom when he played Matt Nost. Managers, they need to get punishment just as bad as competitors do. I like that, Kristen. I'm glad to see. I thought you were going to play the sympathy card there.
No way.
It's my own fault. I thought you were going to play the sympathy card, but thank you. It's good to know that you're on Bateman's side.
I just want to say, as the great Jules Winfield say, it's the path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the iniquities of the selfish and the tyranny of evil men.
And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
Blessed is he who in the name of charity and goodwill shepherds the weak through the valley of darkness, who is truly his brother's keeper and the finder of lost children. And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance and furious anger those who attempt to destroy me. And you will know my name is the Lord when I lay my vengeance upon thee.
Okay.
That was fun. I've always thought of you and me as the Sam Jackson and Travolta.
It's because I'm black.
No.
It's just because I'm brown.
Friend-wise.
Oh.
But okay.
You get killed by Bruce Willis? Who's Bruce Willis? Kristen?
I get killed on the toilet is the thing, and that's the way I think I'm going out.
No, I think he was out of the toilet. He was getting out.
No, he was walking out. He was walking out. But there were Pop-Tarts involved, which I think are going to need to make.
Can we move on? I'm going to move on. All right, we're going to talk about the upcoming matches. There's only one on the schedule at the moment, which is really, really weird. But we have the Founding Fathers versus the Wildberries coming up. The public release being April 25th. I don't really know what the next match is going to be, but the MCU exhibition match is awesome. So definitely watch that. That's up right now, right? Or that hasn't gone up yet?
I don't think it's gone up yet.
The what?
When it comes
out, MCU exhibition.
It's going to be awesome.
Do you guys have tickets for Avengers Endgame opening night?
I do.
No.
Oh yeah.
I'm calling
them right now. We're gonna do a spoiler review on Saturday. We're not gonna shoot a summit. We're gonna do a spoiler review.
We can do both.
Okay, sounds good.
Okay, sounds good.
Well, I'm probably gonna watch
the Founding Fathers versus the Wildberries.
Wobbers.
Okay, so Founding Fathers versus the Wildberries. This is an interesting match because I feel like it's very heavy on one end of the scale as opposed to the other. You have two former champions versus
Just my cool and the Wildberries.
versus two husbands. Yeah, so you got the Wildberries versus the Founding Fathers there. Now,
I'm not going to say that the Wildberries are a bad team, because Josh McCuga has been known to be extremely lucky on occasion. However, the Founding Fathers, there is literally no reason why they should lose this match, especially given the way Dan played to win his belt back. Rocha's last match, he also played really well. I know he lost, but he still played pretty well. So there's no reason why they should lose this match. If they do lose this match, I would be completely shocked. We should probably do a reaction to this match just in case they do lose, so that you guys can watch me be completely shocked. Matt, who do you think is going to win between the Wildberries and the Founding Fathers?
Listen, everybody said, oh, Clark Wolf, she's probably going to TKO Josh McCuga in round one of the 2016 Ultimate Showdown tournament. Obviously. What happened there? Josh McCuga won.
Tim
Draco happens. Oh, Mark and Draco. He's like a million times better. Christian Harloff even said it. What happens? Josh McCuga wins. Every time you count Josh McCuga out, he proves you wrong. So why should we think any less can happen here? Now listen, Rocha and Dan, they're good. They're good. They're good singles players. But as Herb Brooks once said in the amazing movie Miracle, dream teams fail because they rely solely on the individual. The Wildberries work as a team. Okay. The Founding Fathers work as individuals. And this is a team showdown. So who's going to win? Team? Individuals. I'm going with Wildberries.
Okay.
Wildberries.
I mean, like I said.
Hey, I got some sound reasoning there.
Mokuba has been very lucky in the past. So I think your reasoning is fine. I just don't think it's going to happen, but who the heck knows? I've been very wrong.
Yeah, come from the person wearing the Rocha shirt. What did we think?
I'm wearing a top 10 shirt. So it's also Nost, and you know.
Yeah, but he left the league. So
he did leave the league. And
which I'm sad about.
Definitely not going to come back unless something really weird happens. Abe,
what the? Like, Founding Fathers lose to the Wildberries and we get top 10 back? Yay!
Abe, what do you think is going to go down in this match?
I think there's going to be a lot of alcohol involved. I think there's going to be kind of some arguments coming from Rocha and McCuga because of a weird question of wording. I think there's a team is going to lose when it's going to win. It's obviously the Wildberries will come on the top. They will win by 2 points. Founding Fathers will miss their last question, and the Wildberries will win. Just calling it right now.
All right. That sounds good to me, but I think you're wrong.
You don't think that.
But, yeah. Anyway. I mean, that's really all we have left to talk about. I think Matt wanted to talk about something. Matt, do you have
any? Oh, yeah. I really quickly wanted to mention, just do a sort of plug for the Schmodown Patreon. If you guys are not patrons of the Mood Tribute Schmodown, do it for this month's Patreon match. It was Rocky Trivia. It was Tom Dagnino and JT. It was crazy. You want to see two guys know. You think Alex Damon and Joe Scrimshaw playing Star Wars was crazy with how much they know? Look at these two guys. What they know about Rocky, and then something happens during post-match that's going to be real interesting later on in the year when it comes to Patreon. So I'm just saying, guys, become patrons of the Mood Tribute Schmodown for this Rocky trivia match. It is amazing. Just wanted to do my little plug there because I enjoyed it so much. If we were allowed to do reactions to Patreon matches and post them, I probably would have. But
we can do that.
No, but we can't put it on YouTube because then people who aren't patrons can see it for free.
We just can put it on Patreon. Emma posted that once, that if we want, we can just post them privately.
I don't know.
Yeah, you just do it on private, and then people who watch the match can watch my reaction.
Think about it. Well, regardless, I didn't know about that beforehand, but still, go and watch.
All right. Well, that's all we got to talk about this week. Looking forward to next week's match and maybe second match. Who knows what's going on next week? I certainly don't. But yeah, so let's find out where you can find all
of us. I feel like she does.
Okay, let's find out where you can find all of us on the internet. Matt, where can you find yourself?
You know what? I've been asking this question since 1997. Still don't have an answer.
Pretty philosophical question, I have to say.
If you want to find me on social media, you can find me at Kearns_Matthew on Twitter. Please don't try and add me on Facebook or Instagram. Those are private. You can also find me on YouTube at MattMovie611. I'm going to start doing more videos on there. I have 2 videos planned. You can also find me right here. I have 2 shows. Second Look. A new episode will be coming out in a couple of weeks on one of my favorite sports movies that people don't really talk about, which is Moneyball. And you can also find me with my co-host Sandy Robinson on Rhyme and Reason, which is still a show, even though we haven't done an episode in a couple of weeks. We're just time-wise. And so, as always, find me on Shmoedown Content, where I cry because Mark Riley lost. But it's all bullshit. And Ben Hammer better be coming.
All right, Abe, where can we find you?
You can follow me on Twitter at AbrahamF25, where I post things about movies I watch when I came out of the theater, sometimes or sometimes like a day later. You can follow me on Instagram at AbrahamFotos25, where I post pictures of food, because have you looked at my face? Not a pretty face. So that's why I post my food. I think my food looks kind of good. I don't like to give props to myself, but I think I'm a pretty good cook, because I'm not allowed to say some words in the summit because it reminds those people that used to be here. But I just sort of, but it's in the chat, but I'm not allowed to talk about it. And I think I've been muted. So I just want to say, follow me, please. Thank you. I appreciate it. Thank you, Chris.
All right. You invite me at Smith_K10, the number, not the word, on Twitter, Instagram, Stardust, even though I don't post anything on Stardust. You can also find me right here hosting the Reactor Summit whenever the hell we decide we want to put it up.
It's going to go up on Monday. Telling you right now.
Of next year.
It's going to go up whenever the heck it goes up, and we'll do it whenever the heck we feel like doing it. You can also find me hosting our weekly show recapping Game of Thrones next few weeks. Matt doesn't know what it is because he doesn't have taste in TV. But yeah, it's going to be
awesome. I don't have HBO. I'm sorry.
Can we wrap up? I need to go to the throne.
I'm trying. You guys keep talking over me when I'm trying to talk. Goodness gracious. All right. You can find the whole thing on that show. It's going to be awesome. And other than that, yeah, so thanks for watching the summit, where I feel like I'm just gonna murder some people that I work with, and yeah, it's been great, and we'll see you guys all.
I hope no one in your company is watching this, Kristen.
I'm talking about you guys.
Oh, well, that's just me.
Oh, do you work?
Oh, holy!
Bye.